Thank you for that. It's really a tremendous pleasure to be here today and to be able to provide you with an overview of some of the types of problems that my lab over the years has been interested in trying to address. Perhaps a more visual way of looking at this, as opposed to the rather dry title I provided, is reflected on this slide. This slide here. And fundamentally, what my lab has been interested in is understanding how cells sense and respond to changes in their environment. Many of you in this room are no doubt aware of some of the mechanisms by which cells achieve this. Many of you know about our ability to sense changes in light, how that underlies these mechanisms of circadian rhythms, how the circadian rhythms entrain a number of physiological processes as a function of the day-night cycle. And whether or not you're familiar with the underpinning molecular mechanisms that drive those processes, you're almost all certainly aware of what happens when there's dramatic changes in the input into that system. So if you were to hop on a plane, fly to another time zone, you'll experience what's referred to as jet lag. But you also realize after a day or two of this that your body begins to adapt. And your body adapts in large part because there are sensors within dedicated cells whose job it is to recognize the differences in the patterns of light and dark and to sort of reset the circadian rhythms in order to accommodate the new environment that you're in. Now, this holds true not only for light, but for a number of different inputs, and that's really what makes cells quite remarkable, in my view, is both the diversity and number of different types of inputs that can be recognized and responded to. And so they include light, they include temperature, they include mechanical stress, so pulling or pushing on cells. They can include the status of pathogenic infection. It can include the amount and diversity of nutrients that one's consuming at any given time. And it can include this example here at the bottom, exemplified by this woman whose environment is changing as a function of her hiking in the mountains and climbing to altitude. And the oxygen demands that are changing as a function of that. Now, I can certainly sympathize with her. A little over a week ago, I traveled from Dallas to Breckenridge, Colorado to attend a meeting. And one of the first things I noticed when I got off the plane was I was very short of breath. It was probably actually the second thing I noticed when I got off the plane, aside from the cold and the snow. But simply walking walking through the baggage claim with my luggage, you notice you're short of breath. And that's largely due to the fact that at high altitude, there's less oxygen available in the atmosphere. And so if one were to peek inside of what was going on in my body, you would see something that's sort of illustrated on this cartoon. Oops, we'll go back. In a typical body such as mine, the red blood cells, it's their job to transport oxygen to various tissues throughout the body, including the kidneys. Now, when I traveled to high altitude and oxygen delivery was compromised as a function of not having enough oxygen to satisfy the metabolic needs of my cells, there are sensing mechanisms for that in the cells of my kidney, and the kidneys sense that lack of oxygen or hypoxia, and they respond by inducing a change in gene expression. And this change in gene expression leads to the production of a small hormone called erythropoietin. Erythropoietin is excreted by the kidneys. It goes to sites in the body, such as the bone marrow, where new red blood cells are made, and it induces the production of even more red blood cells. So more red blood cells means more oxygen carrying capacity. That reestablishes the ability of those red blood cells to deliver oxygen to my kidneys. My kidneys are happy. They shut down the production of erythropoietin. And this is a really elegant example of maintaining this physiological balance or homeostasis. And so as I stayed in Colorado for several days, I began to adapt. And this is one of the mechanisms by which my body began to adapt. Now, what was always interesting to me in my lab as it relates to pathways such as this is what precisely is within the kidneys that's sensing that change in oxygen availability. What's that oxygen sensor look like? And how did that sensing of oxygen lead to a change in gene expression of something like erythropoietin? And at the beginning of my career at UT Southwestern, we began to try and address some of those questions. And I'll just give the punchline here. And it turns out that this change in EPO expression is largely driven by the differential induction of a protein called the transcription factor. The particular transcription factor that we've been interested in is this one called hypoxia-inducible factor, or HIF. And the neat thing about HIF is that the cells in the kidney, they're always making this transcription factor. They're always making this HIF subunit. And yet, when there's plenty of oxygen around, this HIF protein is targeted for degradation. And it's degraded because it gets marked with a special modification, this hydroxylation event. And it's that hydroxylation event that allows it to be recognized by another protein complex. It's a member of a family called E3 ligases. And the job of this protein family is to recognize specific proteins and mark them for being degraded within the cell by a machine called the proteasome. You can think of that as the garbage disposal of a cell. And so under conditions of high oxygen, even though you're always making this guy, it's always being degraded, so it doesn't accumulate. But this modification event that places this particular hydroxylation mark here doesn't take place under low oxygen conditions. And the work of our group and other groups a little over a decade ago now was able to track why there's this differential modification of the transcription factor. And that's because the enzymes that we and others had identified, these prolyl hydroxylase enzymes that are responsible for making this modification on the transcription factor, are oxygen-dependent enzymes. If you were to look at the active side of these enzymes, you'd see that they are iron-dependent enzymes. They utilize small molecule metabolites as a co-substrates, and they use molecular oxygen as a substrate, basically splitting that oxygen into allowing one of those oxygen atoms to modify, say, a target proline residue, while the other goes on to modify this intermediate metabolite. And so by virtue of oxygen being a substrate for these enzymes, you can imagine how that can be used to sense oxygen within a cell. So if oxygen levels are high within a cell, there's a great deal of activity here, there's a lot of modification and a lot of degradation. Conversely, if there's low oxygen within the cell, you get low levels of modification. So in and of itself, I think this was a really interesting discovery that we've helped contribute it to, and yet there's a lot of medicinal relevance here. And so in the intervening decades since we and others discovered this family of enzymes, there's been a lot of work by a number of pharmaceutical companies to exploit this mechanism in the treatment of various diseases. And so it turns out that erythropoietin is given therapeutically to patients who are experiencing chronic kidney failure, for example. They no longer may retain the ability themselves to make sufficient erythropoietin and make enough red blood cells. And so over the years, this has probably netted companies like Amgen, you know, somewhere on the order of hundreds of billions of dollars in sales for the treatment of anemia in the context of chronic kidney disease. In the coming years, I think you'll see a large push to replace EPO with inhibitors that have been developed against these family of enzymes that basically block the ability of these enzymes to target HIF for degradation, and they would have the effect of inducing this transcription factor that turns on EPO as well as a number of genes that perhaps coordinate the erythropoietic response along with EPO and give maybe a more physiologically relevant response. And so the most advanced of those projects now, I believe, are in phase 3 trials. There are thousands of patients receiving inhibitors of these family of enzymes, and beyond their potential use in the context of treating anemia, I think they'll also be tested in the context of potential neuroprotective or cardioprotective effects in the context of diseases where oxygen availability is also compromised. This includes the lack of oxygen that one encounters in strokes and heart attacks, for example. And so I think there's a lot of exciting potential along the way. Now, any good scientific project that one embarks on should inspire a whole new set of questions and not just answer ones that you thought you were interested in when you started out. Our work on this pathway led us to think a little bit more about iron homeostasis. Iron is a cofactor for these enzymes. The chemical properties of iron make it very useful for these and many other enzymes to carry out their biological functions. And yet the reactivity of iron makes it potentially detrimental. So if cells in your body were to accumulate too much iron, that can lead to oxidative stress that can damage proteins, nucleic acids, lipids within the cell. And so just like it's important to maintain oxygen availability within a particular physiological range, it's also important to maintain iron availability within a particular physiological range. And so this can happen both at the whole body or systemic level. Most of the iron that we need every day, which works out to about 20 to 25 milligrams of iron, goes to the production of new red blood cells. We may have all been impressed with the amount of diapers that P&G can crank out at a time. I can tell you that basically every second that you're sitting here listening to me, your body is turning over about 5 million red blood cells and having to replace those. An even more impressive machine, perhaps. Most of the iron that goes into these processes comes from the recycling of iron from these dying red blood cells that is recovered upon phagocytosis or ingestion of these red blood cells by the macrophages. Although a fair amount still is required from our diet each day and is absorbed by our intestines. And that basically makes up the amount of iron we lose in various uncontrolled manners each day. For example, the sloughing off of the skin cells or hair. And so it's certainly important to maintain a balance within the body of liberating this iron and making it available for the production of new red blood cells and coordinating that with the uptake of iron. But this happens not only at the whole organism level, but this also happens at the level of each individual cell in our body. And so the particular players on this cartoon aren't important. What is important is to know that there are dedicated proteins whose job it is to take up iron, to utilize iron, to store excess iron in a form that prevents it from reacting inappropriately within cells, and also to export that iron. And these gene products all need to be coordinated in a logical and physiologically relevant way. If you're a cell that has too much iron, you want to decrease the ability of that cell to take up iron, and you want to increase the storage capacity for iron so that it doesn't react inappropriately. If you've got too little iron, you want to take up more iron, and you don't want to hide it away in the context of something like ferritin over here. And so you have to have these reciprocal levels of gene regulation as a function of iron availability to maintain homeostasis. We've known a lot about this pathway over the years. It turns out there are two key regulatory proteins. These aren't transcription factors like HIF. They're RNA binding proteins, referred to as iron regulatory protein 1 and iron regulatory protein 2. Their job is to bind particular RNA elements within the mRNA products of those genes that were highlighted on the appropriate slide. And depending where these proteins bind, they can either repress or induce expression of those particular genes. And without going through the nitty-gritty details, they do so in a way that allows a cell to respond appropriately. What is important for the nature or the purposes of this talk is to understand that the ability of these proteins to bind RNA is regulated as a function of both iron and oxygen, much as the HIF pathway is. And much like that HIF example, this IRP2 protein is selectively targeted for degradation by the proteasome under high iron and high oxygen conditions. And though this was reminiscent of what was going on in the hypoxic pathway, the underlying mechanisms turned out to be very different. And this is something that we explored at some length, given our interest in these types of sensing and signaling mechanisms. Work in our lab over the years has identified a different member of that E3 ligase family. This is, again, the family whose job it is to mark proteins for degradation. They mark it by putting this little ubiquitin tag onto these protein substrates. This is the complex of proteins we identified as the E3 ligase for this IRP2 protein. It's characterized by this common scaffold of proteins, skip, call, RBX. And the job of this scaffold is really to bring this particular specificity subunit, very cleverly called FBXL5, in close proximity to this protein that brings along the ubiquitin that's going to get added to substrate. Now, the neat thing about finding players in these pathways is it opens up opportunities both for therapeutic intervention and for understanding how physiology is regulated in these pathways. And by identifying this complex, we began to learn more about how iron actually impinges upon IRP2 stability. And that's because this FBXL5 protein itself is regulated as a function of iron and oxygen. And so this is a Western blot. It shows the level of accumulation of proteins such as IRP2. One can take cells under high iron conditions where normally this protein is degraded and shift them to low iron conditions and see it accumulate over the period of hours. One can do the reciprocal experiment, growing cells under low iron conditions and then moving into high iron conditions and watching this protein disappear. And if one looks at this FBXL5 protein under the same conditions, you can see that it's actually regulated the level of its own stability in a completely reciprocal manner. And by having this insight and knowing that the real interesting regulation was taking place on the E3 ligase and not on the substrate, we were able, through a series of experiments, to identify how iron was actually being sensed by this protein complex. And it was being sensed, in this case, not by an enzyme whose activity was dependent on iron, such as what happened with the HIF story, but rather a conformational switch. It turns out that FBXL5 subunit has a domain at its N-terminus, which here I show the structure of that domain. It's eerily similar to another type of domain called a heme-erythrin domain. Now, heme-erythrin domains have never been found in mammalian proteins before. They've been found in a number of bacterial genomes and in these worms that live at the bottom of the ocean in these deep sea vents. But the interesting thing about this domain is its architecture. It's this bundle of alpha helices that's held together by these two iron atoms. And so one can immediately identify or appreciate that this has the potential for being a conformational switch. If there's a lot of iron in the cell, it's going to assemble in this type of bundle and hold it in a very compact conformation. And under low iron conditions, this domain basically unfolds, and upon unfolding, exposes a regulatory element that promotes the degradation of this E3 ligase. And you can see this type of model here, where we have high iron conditions that promote the assembly of this domain. This stabilizes this FBXL5 protein and allows it to bind substrate and then target that substrate for degradation by this garbage disposal, the proteasome. Under low iron conditions, you get a different conformation, and that now allows this protein, this FBXL5 protein, to be recognized by yet another E3 ligase that targets it for degradation, and now FBXL5 substrates are stable and able to go and do the jobs that they're supposed to do. There's absolutely no doubt that this is a physiological iron sensor. If one were to go into Dr. Beutler's bank of a million mutant mice and pull out a mouse that had the FBXL5 gene inactivated, you would find that there was, in fact, no mice born that lacked both copies of this gene. It's embryonic lethal. These mice die during embryogenesis because they lack the ability to sense how much iron they've got. They are acting as though they're not getting enough iron. They accumulate excess levels of iron that induces large amounts of oxidative stress, and those embryos die. Now, in a therapeutic context, that may not sound like it's too terribly relevant, and yet one can do other types of experiments. In this case, we compared wild-type mice to mice that only lack one copy of FBXL5. So they make some of this sensor, but not as much as a wild-type mouse might. Now, If you were to put those two mice side by side, you really wouldn't notice any differences between them. They look about the same, they behave about the same. And yet, if you challenge them with different diets, you get very different outcomes. So this is a wild-type mouse. We've fed it either an iron-sufficient diet or a low-iron diet. And you can see when you feed a mouse a low-iron diet that it starts to get signs of anemia, right? There's not enough iron to make more hemoglobin to incorporate into red blood cells. And so their red blood cell counts go down, their hemoglobin levels go down, their hematocrits go down. Now, if you were to do the same feeding experiment in a mouse that only has one copy of FBXL5, you see something a little bit different and unexpected, and that is these mice are immune to these changes in dietary iron. They do much better on a low iron diet than their wild-type counterparts. And that may seem a little bit counterintuitive at first, but what really has happened and what we've been able to track down is that these heterozygous mice basically are hypersensitive in terms of their ability to sense iron within the intestine. And so there's something very privileged about the intestine in terms of iron sensing exacerbated in these mice. And so when you feed a mouse that lacks one copy and you were to give it, say, radio-labeled iron and follow the absorption of that radio-labeled iron, you can see a wild-type mouse doesn't do a very good job at taking that iron up in the intestine, although over time it does. And there's a dramatic difference between the ability of these heterozygous mice to do so. And that's because if one were to go and study the changes in gene expression in those mice, you would see that the mouse that lacks one copy of this gene is already sort of primed to behave as though it were a low iron mouse in the intestine, and it's already sort of upregulated the machinery to take up iron by that mechanism. And so now by understanding in the precise details who are the players that are responsible for iron absorption within the animal, and then understanding that these sensors perhaps are set differently in differential tissues, now we have a set of conditions which we might be able to exploit therapeutically to address problems of iron-deficient anemia, which affect somewhere in the order of billions of people worldwide, including many people in this country. And so these other examples just simply point out that the iron that's absorbed by these mice ultimately ends up incorporated into red blood cells. And so even though I didn't have time to really go into it today, there's definitely a lot of crosstalk between these types of pathways. The HIF transcription factor, which includes its regulated subunit and its constitutive partner, actually ends up driving the expression of many genes involved in iron homeostasis. That can affect the iron status of the cell, which affects the activity of these iron regulatory proteins that can indirectly feed back to HIF. Turns out that HIF is in fact a direct target for these IRP proteins. And our lab over the last decade or so has identified at least two different kinds of sensors that really sit at the nexus of these two pathways, whose job it is to sense the levels of bioavailable iron and oxygen within the cell and help coordinate the regulation of these pathways. And certainly, I think from a therapeutic and medicinal point of view, we're not far off from exploiting this type of information for potentially the treatment of anemia. And if one looks at the role of these biological pathways in many other physiological contexts, one can find that intervention through some of these players might well have beneficial effects in other contexts where these sensing components play a role, and that includes cancer. And while that the cancer sort of stories are maybe a few years behind where the anemia stories are, I think they're likely to be coming in coming years in terms of iron overload disease such as hemochromatosis. And I think there's other contexts that are potentially exciting down the road. It's certainly an honor to have been invited here as an O'Donnell Award winner. And while I'm certainly humbled by the recognition, there's no doubt that this is really a reflection not so much on me, but by the many talented people who have come and worked in my lab over the years, the terrific and enthusiastic and willing colleagues that I've had at UT Southwestern, and the vision of the leadership at UT Southwestern, which has provided an infrastructure that allows even a relatively small lab such as myself to tackle these problems from the point of view of chemistry, to biophysics, to biochemistry, to physiology. And with that, I'll take questions. Yeah, so in some ways I'm probably the outlier of the theme of computational biology at this meeting. No one will ever confuse me as a computational biologist, but it would be disingenuous to assume that computational approaches didn't play a large role in some of the discoveries we've made, whether it's bioinformatic insights into how these sensors might be working, and in fact, one of my colleagues here, Nick Grisham, played a large role in helping us understand what was going on in that context, from the computational role, the computational roles that are played in structure determination, to our ability at UT Southwestern to take the tools and reagents that are developed in the course of these types of projects and to do high-throughput screening approaches where we're investigating the effects of hundreds of thousands of different compounds and their ability to perturb systems like that. So we certainly benefit from colleagues who can bring computational approaches to bear on our problems.
Very nice talk. I wanted to ask if you had looked at the role of antioxidants and how they play an effect on IRP2.
There's certainly a lot of literature in both fields in terms of the roles of antioxidants. As to how much of the contributions these particular sensors make to the reported contributions of antioxidants, I think still remains in some ways a complicated and unanswered question, but certainly when you're dealing with metals such as iron, you have a large potential to respond to different levels of oxidative or reductive stress. But in terms of the particulars and the nitty-gritties, sometimes the literature gets a little bit complex and convoluted, let's say.